Hello, everyone. I'm Linda Ayers. Welcome to Tuesday Talks, brought to you by Cleveland Park Main Street, Woodley Park Main Street, the Cleveland and Woodley Park Village, and the DC Public Library. Please feel free to post your comments and questions at any time during tonight's talk. You can do this through the comments or Q&A function on your screen. And at the end of tonight's presentation, Marissa Bateman from the library will field your questions. Tonight's topic is Enraptured by Raptors, the story of the Cleveland Park Hawks. It's the title of a recent book by Jennifer Packard, and it chronicles how a family of red-shouldered hawks found its way into the heart of an urban community during uncertain times. Jennifer Packard is a photographer specializing in architecture and interiors, nature, and portraiture. She also creates large-scale contemporary photo illustrations for corporate offices. She has taught photography to lifelong learning adults, as well as to gifted and talented high school students. And she's used photography as a rehabilitative tool for homeless women and at-risk youth. She also volunteers her photographic skills at Tregaron Conservancy. Jen will be in conversation tonight with Amy Henderson. As a historian at the National Portrait Gallery, Amy wrote books and curated exhibitions on broadcasting, Broadway, Hollywood, and dance. She continues to write reviews and essays, most notably for Arts Magazine. Welcome, Jen and Amy. It's good to have you here tonight.
It's great to be here. Thank you, Linda.
Great. Thank you, Linda. Well, welcome, everybody. Welcome, welcome. So we're going to just do a conversation, Jen and I, about how she discovered, we all discovered, the hawk family that nested last March under the Klingel Bridge in Klingel Valley. That's where I met Jen. We had never known each other before. We're all in the neighborhood, but we just hadn't met. So I think I'll start by asking Jen, when did you first learn about the hawk nest?
That's a great question, Amy. Thank you. I first learned of the hawk nest, it was, as you said, in March of 2020, and I was going for a walk. It was a lovely spring day, and as I was walking across the Connecticut Avenue Bridge, I noticed a very large nest. And I'll begin my slideshow so you can see what everything looks like here. Because I know you all want to see some pictures. Okay.
That's how Jen and I met. I saw this woman taking photographs every day, and I thought, oh, that's interesting. And one day I asked her, have you been chronicling this whole process? And she said, yes.
Can everybody see the first photograph?
Not yet. I think we need to share it.
Okay.
There we go.
Great.
There you go.
Okay, so you can see of course, Washington, D.C. folks are familiar with the Connecticut Avenue Bridge in Northwest D.C., but here's a photograph of it, and there is the nest. So as I was saying, I was walking across the bridge, and I saw this empty nest, and it's very unusual. I suspected it might be a hawk's nest. I suspected that since this was a new nest I'd never seen before, that there's probably some hawk parents nearby. And I came back the next day with my camera to see what I could see. The nest was vacant again, but I did see the two parents-to-be, whom I named Walt and Libby.
And why did you name them Walt and Libby?
You know, it began initially as a social experiment, Amy. I wanted to see if the names would come back to me. And sure enough, they did. Walt's named after my dad, who was an ardent bird follower, lover. He fed all the birds in Western New York State through all the snowstorms. And Libby was named after one of my best friend's mom, who had three hatchlings of her own. So, and you know, it's also convenient too, because when you're talking about something, it's easy to have a name for it. So I could say, I saw Walt today, and folks would know who I was talking about.
And you could tell which one, I mean, you could tell that these were hawks that were the ones that were at building the nest. I mean, it was an impressive nest. It was if it caught my attention, because I'm not a bird watcher by trade. I mean, there's a robin, there's a cardinal, you know, that's me. So when I saw this huge nest, I thought, is this some, you know, humongous squirrel? But then as we got going, I realized, no, these are hawks. And at a certain point, fairly early on, after they got the nest built, people started to congregate at the bridge to look. It was fascinating because it was an impressive nest, and it was just something out of the ordinary as we walked down Connecticut Avenue to catch sight of these birds.
They did. And, you know, it was a real treat because typically hawks build their nests about 3/4 of the way up in a tree. So to actually have the nest at eye level, it's just unheard of to be able to see right inside. And so this is in April. So the hatchlings were actually, I noticed them first on April 10th, 2020. And I initially saw two little hatchlings and we were all so excited. And then shortly thereafter, a little later in the day, I saw a third.
Aww.
I have to tell you how I named these little hatchlings. So I named the first one COVID after, of course, the times we were living in. And the second one named Cleveland after Cleveland Park and President Cleveland, of course. Now the third one, it's pretty funny. Up until we actually saw the third, we thought there were only two. Well, while we were standing on the bridge, we saw the third appear and we got so excited. So at that moment, a woman was walking across the bridge and said, "What are you all looking at?" And we said, look, there's a third hatchling. And she had never seen a hawk before, let alone a hatchling. And she was excited too. And I said, "What is your name, ma'am?" And she said, "Dorothy." And I said, "The third hatchling is named Dorothy." So that's how she got her name.
Now, Jen, tell us a little bit about, these are red-shouldered hawks.
Yes.
So can you talk about what that species is like?
Sure. I think most folks are more familiar with the red-tailed hawks. Now, the red-shouldered hawks are a little bit smaller than the red-tailed. Notice that they have an orange chest and shoulders, of course. So that's how you can identify them.
It's a beautiful bird.
They truly are. So they typically like to live in woodland areas next to a stream. So down below is the Klingle Stream, the Klingle Valley, where there's lots of nutritious food for them to hunt. It's actually an ideal situation because there's all kinds of amphibians and frogs. There's, of course, squirrels, small birds. Now, people ask me, what is a raptor exactly? And raptors have sharp beaks, large talons, and excellent eyesight. So all this combined, and of course, they are carnivores too. So that's a little bit about red-shouldered hawks and raptors.
You know, after I started talking to you every day on the bridge as you were taking photos, I looked at your photos and I noticed that you captured the moment from the beginning. And at some point, because I know you do podcasts and websites, but I said, have you ever thought of these photos would make a wonderful book?
What I did was I started with a blog and every day I would upload my photographs and my field notes. And I had a really good response from the blog and folks were starting to say, including yourself, you should do a book. So right. I started the book in May and published in October.
And you can see from the photos on the bridge here, the diversity of the folks that we've got here. We've got a worker in a hard hat up on the top right. We've got a little boy, his name is Tucka. He's a neighbor of mine on the bottom left side. The man in the middle with a big long lens is the ambassador from Switzerland. So we had quite a diverse crowd. And you can see people lined up along the bridge there, which they did all the time, every day.
They did. And the beauty of this story, Amy, is that, you know, when you think about March, April, May, those were really trying times for everybody because, you know, right. We had a national pandemic going on. We had, Black Lives Matter, a lot of important issues happening, as well as the lead up to the election. So they were uncertain times. So people would take breaks on their Zoom calls, you know, during the lunch and so forth, and go outside when it was nice. And they would watch these hawks. And for a period of time, it really felt like time was suspended on that bridge.
That's exactly right. And you felt like there was a kind of a community of folks that had nothing in common, but mm-hmm. an interest in what was happening in that nest. So it was mm-hmm. a gathering that was a very communal activity in a very disruptive time.
It was indeed.
People were sharing, the idea that people shared so much. Did you see that? Or this is what I feel about that. So it was quite an extraordinary experience in a crummy time.
Everyone was different, but we all had an appreciation for nature before us.
Right. And then everything was going along smoothly. And look at those babies. Yes. And then one day there was a bad thing happened. A neighbor of mine here at the Kennedy Warren called me and said, Amy, there's a big bird stuck in a tree out in the back. And I went out and I saw a big bird stuck in a tree. And I got one of my neighbors, Dan Newton, who works at the zoo. And Dan, the zoo was closed, so Dan was home. And he came right out with me in the back. And he instantly got on his telephone and gathered up, I think, the curator of cheetahs. There weren't a lot of people working at the zoo then, but Dan got a whole bunch of them to come. And there was a fence that divided the zoo woods from the back of the Kennedy Warren. And the big bird, which turned out to be the Papa Hawk, was caught up way up in a tree that had, the tree was based on the zoo property, but it leaned over onto the Kennedy Warren property. And pretty soon there was maybe 10 people out in the back, both on the zoo side and on the our side, the Kennedy Warren side, looking up saying, how are we going to rescue that poor bird? Because it was having a terrible time. He was caught up in the tree and his wing was caught somehow and he was thrashing around. And finally, I think it was one of the bird curators at the zoo called the Owl Moon Raptor Center. Right, Jen?
That's right.
And they came, and of course my solution was chop the tree down. And everyone, nobody said that was a good idea. So the Owl Moon Raptor Center called Bartlett's Trees. And pretty soon there was this young guy scampering up these little trees going out on branches that would be hard to, for most people to balance on. And he had this huge leather sack. And he cut down the bird because the bird had been caught in fishing line. The papa bird had been out hunting for, well, frogs probably, and got snagged in fishing line. And that's what had really got his wings snagged up in the tree. The fellow, the arborist from Bartlett's Trees, got him down into the leather sack, got right back down to the tree. They put him into a carrying case, and Owl Moon took him off to their Raptor Center, right, Jen?
That's right, in Maryland. It was about a 45-minute drive.
And it's a young, strong bird, and pretty soon they discovered he wasn't really hurt. They clipped he was young and strong, and he practiced flying, and they have some sort of indoor flying center for raptors, right?
They do. They have a whole rehabilitation program.
And so this happened, he was snagged on Friday. By, I think it was Sunday evening, they brought him back and released him near where he had been snagged. Now, the part of the story that I find fascinating too is, meanwhile, Papa Bird is off, he's disappeared. Mama Bird has these three chicks, and she's got to protect them from predators like, owls.
Mm-hmm.
And she's also got to feed them, so she's got... Usually the birds take turns. The papa will be out hunting, while the mother protects the chicks, but she had to do both, and she was yelling all weekend. You could hear her screeching and yelling, kind of saying, "Where are you? I need your help." And finally, when he was released and recovered, he came right, soon he was right back in the nest, and they proceeded doing what they were always doing. There he comes back. Is that Walt coming back?
That was Walt returning. That wasn't the very moment he returned, but it was shortly thereafter.
And then they were all reunited.
Yeah. It was very concerning because had Walt not been able to recover and return, it's a great possibility that the hatchlings would not have survived, because it really does take two at this point, at these early stages when the hatchlings are so young. They need the mother with them to keep them warm while the father hawk hunts. So we're so happy to see him come back.
And now, and so what surprised me too is the hawkling, the little ones, they grew from little fuzz balls, and they grew fast. I mean, this is, they grew quite, I don't know enough about raptors to understand that they just kind of explode in size within a month.
They do. Well, they are in the incubation period for 4 to 5 weeks. That's how long that the mother, Libby, sat on the eggs in order to incubate them. And then they stay in the nest approximately 35 to 45 days before they fledge. And I'd like to talk about this particular set of pictures. It was very interesting that the mother hawk would go and bring fresh greens to put in the nest to make it nice for them. And she would do this periodically, you know, to keep it comfortable and dry in there. So this is what she's doing.
And Jen and I both had a favorite, because the youngest one, the littlest one, the last to hatch, Dorothy, was a feisty bird. And she, when the food would come, the bigger, you know, chicks would try to grab the food, but Dorothy was right in there, and she was snagging it and grabbing it back for herself. And so, whereas in some situations you would think, oh, well, the young, scrawny little one is not going to make it and will just be dropped out of the nest. Not Dorothy. No. Dorothy was a fighter and a survivor. And so she became our favorite.
She did. She became everybody's favorite because we got to enjoy her in the nest a little longer than the other two that had fledged. And she was quite a character, actually.
And so they're getting ready to fledge now, right?
Yeah, they fledge approximately 35 to 45 days after hatching. You mentioned something earlier about the feeding, and I'd like to show you something also very fascinating that we learned. So this is likely Libby, and she's sitting on the, I call it the old twisty branch, which was a common perch for them to meet, and she's waiting for Walt to bring something from the wild, a meal. So what happens is Walt provides her with that. It's the handoff, and then she goes and feeds the young ones. And so here's the young ones here standing in line waiting for their meal. And Dorothy's on the far right. And people say, well, how do you know? And I can tell because her feathers haven't completely matured yet. You can kind of tell that she has a little bit more down than the other two.
And they're very intent. Food, food, food.
They eat several times a day. Here's the father hawk bringing in an amphibian, I think from Tregaron's lily pond. And how do I know this is Walt, you ask? Because the males tend to be much more slender than the females. The females are a little bit rotund. And that's to help with, during the incubation period, they can keep the chicks warm. So here's the father coming in with the meal. They look excited.
Oh yeah, they're ready.
They are ready. So the first to fledge was COVID. Well, we think he's the oldest. Conveniently, there's a little branch there. I called it the runway, and it's where they would stand and practice by flapping their wings, getting a little bit of air, hopping up and down. And what's interesting is the young siblings are watching so intently.
What is he doing?
Yes. Will we be doing that next? They're wondering. So everybody at the bridge knew that it was going to happen soon because COVID was out on that runway quite a bit. And sure enough, on May 26th, he spread his wings and flew to a nearby tree.
Yay, COVID. Boy, and his siblings must have been stunned.
I'm sure they were. Probably wondered where he went to.
And Dorothy probably thought, more food for me.
No doubt. This is the second day, the day after he fledged. He returned to the nest. He was so hungry because he's too young to hunt for himself yet. So they have to return to the nest for their feeding. So you can see it. He's looking down. In the middle picture, you see him looking down on his siblings. And he was trying to negotiate how to land, which he didn't want to land on Dorothy and Cleveland, but he did pretty good. He made it into the nest, and of course, mom or dad came in with some victuals shortly thereafter.
And how did, there she is. There's our Dorothy.
Yes, this is indeed. Dorothy. We would joke that it took some time for her to grow into her talons.
Can you see her feet like way out there? Now, the people on the bridge are watching and keeping track of how the hawklets fledge. It was fascinating because everybody was intent and saying, will it be today? What's happening today?
Yes. Did you see what Dorothy ate today? It was big talk around town here. This is Dorothy as well. So you notice on the left how her neck looks funny. I always joke that she's not a morning person. But she's losing her down and she's getting her feathers. They're growing back in. And she was the last to fledge. So on the lower right there, that's her dad, Walt, and the two of them are having a moment, and he had just brought her some food to eat. So she got to enjoy some one-on-one time with her dad, which was nice.
But then pretty soon it's Dorothy's turn.
Yes. And this is a sequence of Dorothy. As you notice, she's looking a little bit different. She's got all of her feathers in, and Amy and I joke that this is the Maria Callas.
Yes, the Maria Callas of Hawkton, because she's getting ready to sing dramatically. Dorothy has an amazing voice, and I think she mimicked her mother's voice very loud, and you could always tell if it wasn't the mother that it was Dorothy. And I love this sequence because she takes a bow. So I call her. Callas was, of course, a dramatic soprano in the 50s and 60s, and very dramatic. So,
very.
With a great voice. So I nicknamed Dorothy the Maria Callas of Hawkton. But now look at Dorothy's front feathers.
Yeah, you know, it's interesting that we didn't notice this on the other two, but on Dorothy, her plumage in the front has little hearts.
Little hearts, yes. It's all Dorothy. Yes.
How appropriate, because we loved her so much. We loved them all, though, didn't we, Amy?
Oh, yeah. Oh, absolutely. And the cool thing is, and you're the expert here, they will pretty much stay in Klingle Valley and surroundings, right?
Yes, that's the wonderful thing, is they only go 2 to 3 miles away, realize that they are competing for food among each other. But they typically reuse the same nest. The same parents will use the same nest, provided the nest is in good shape and they liked it the year prior. So we're hoping to see them again this spring in the nest.
And the other thing, the other chapter in their growing up that I love is when they have fledged, and so they're not really in the nest anymore, except they come back to eat. And the parents have to kind of, at a certain point, discourage that. So teaching the hawklets that they have how to hunt themselves, that was fascinating, because you would hear the hawklets up in different trees going, screeching, "I want to eat now." and the mama and papa hawk saying, interesting thought. So they had to teach the kids how to hunt.
They did, and they actually become independent 14 to 16 weeks after they fledge the nest. And during that time, they're modeling their parents' behavior. Initially, they're able to capture small insects to eat, but they'll be calling for their parent and watching them and learning how to hunt.
And meanwhile, the parents keep feeding them a little bit, right?
They do. They do. Until they become completely independent.
So what are we seeing here now?
On June 2nd, Dorothy fledged, finally. And we often said that we wish she would just stay in the nest forever, because it was just so fun to see her in there. And but, you know, everyone has to fly the coop eventually. So this is Dorothy on a branch, and she is hopping up and down, getting some air in her wings. And before we knew it, she leapt. And you can see her little feet and talons dangling there. It took her a little bit to get them back in. She flies away, and then she lands, a perfect, beautiful landing on a branch. And then she looks back to where she was and to all of us, cheering, of course. It was a great moment.
You have some recent photos. The hawks, I see, I like to think it's Dorothy, sometimes up in high up in a tree in Klingle Valley. And she likes to sit in the sun. She just kind of faces the sun for hours sometimes.
Yeah, they do like to sit in the sun. This is COVID sitting in the sun, actually. And you can tell the difference between the juveniles. Now, they're juveniles for 2 years, and they don't mate until that second year, and that's when they have their own family. So so the fledglings that we got to know last year, they have another year before they have families of their own. But in order to distinguish them out in the wild, you can see that their patterns on their chest right now look like this,
right,
as opposed to here. And we think that this is Libby, who was on. She was on the old twisty branch last week.
Right. I saw her.
This was one day last week, and so she's sitting there, and then all of a sudden she flies off. You can see her big talons, but you'll notice that her chest is barred. It doesn't have those little spots as COVID does here.
So the hawk family story has such resonance. And I think it's partly because we were in such extraordinary times when we were searching for something good to think about, and a story of nature and rebirth is a pretty good story. Do you find that true in the people you've talked to?
I do. Those were difficult times in the early months last year. And I know for myself, I've always been a nature lover and a wildlife appreciator, but I came across a lot of people who haven't, you know, people who've lived in cities their whole lives, and they really hadn't had an opportunity to appreciate it like this, because everything in the world slowed down, like to a halt. You know, some folks lost their jobs even. So they didn't have an opportunity to pause and really reflect on nature, to see it right before their eyes. And this was a great opportunity for that, for everyone, even for people who've seen it before.
I mean, it was extraordinary to have that bridge on Connecticut Avenue in a right in the middle of Klingle Valley in Rock Creek Park. I mean, I remember one day, one of my favorite stories was one of the L2 buses coming up Connecticut Avenue. and so that people could see the nest.
As well as the police.
Yeah. John Kelly, who's a columnist for the Washington Post, wrote a column about the hawk nest, and when Walt had been snagged and then rescued and recovered, and the family got back together. So even the Washington Post was interested in the mm-hmm. hawk family story.
And WTOP.
Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed.
Yeah. So,
and your book, the book that came out this fall.
Yes.
It does have, your photographs tell the story of this family so well. And guess who's on the cover?
That's our little Dorothy. That's right.
Dorothy, yes, indeed. But the photographs just tell the story that those of us that watched it for a couple of months last spring were enraptured by.
Mm-hmm.
And the book has done pretty well, I think.
Thank you, Amy. I know a lot of folks have read it, and I'd like to say, though, that the message of the book, for those who haven't, is really quite simple. I find that when we learn about nature and wildlife, the more we learn about it, the more we appreciate it. And the more we appreciate it, the more we want to protect it. So in protecting it, my conservation message is, in part, the Environmental Protection Agency states that, as well as Alamoon Raptor Center, plastic is one of the most detrimental things that can hinder wildlife. So when you're outside going for a walk, if you're by the stream, on the shore, if you see plastic, please dispose of it properly, because that can be ingested in the wildlife and ultimately ingested by humans as well. So that's how you can help. And I always think, when I pick up a piece of plastic or a rubber band, I think maybe I'm saving a life, you know, like Walt and ultimately the whole family of hawks.
Right, right. Now, do you have some advice for people who aren't professional photographers, but may have gotten fascinated by the idea of taking photographs of hawks or other wildlife? Do you have any advice to give them?
Oh, I do. I do. The greatest piece of advice that I can give anyone is to become a naturalist as much as possible. Learn about what it is you're photographing. When I started photographing the hawks, I read everything I could about them, everything I could find, to learn, you know, when they were going to hatch, what they hunted. And when I learned about their habits, then I was able to be right there to capture them. So I would say that's probably the best thing, best advice that I have. And keep the sun at your back.
Oh, that's a good idea. Yes. Yes. Oh, and we should say that Enraptured by Raptors is available at some local bookstores, Politics and Prose, Transcendence in the Woodley Park neighborhood, and of course on Amazon and Barnes and Noble.
Now, folks are familiar with the Raptor blog that I had last year. It has a new home in Raptured by Raptors website, which is where you can read more about the book. But this blog continues in its new home, and feel free to read it and keep up with everything that's going on. And occasionally there'll be cameos from other raptors other than our hawks here in Cleveland Park.
And I think we should say too that over 800 copies of the book have been sold.
Yes, that's true.
And all proceeds are going to the Alamoon Raptor Center, which rescued in...
That's right. All proceeds go to Alamoon Raptor Center. Thanks for reminding me.
Well, it's been a good deal, and they do such good work that it's...
They do.
And, you know, the other thing we can think of, this is middle of February, almost the end of February, and it was March last spring that Libby and Walt built that nest. So next month, we don't have much time now, we can start checking out what is happening in that giant, because the nest is there. Mm-hmm. They build built a strong, durable nest. And this morning it had snow in it still, but that'll melt away.
Right.
So you gotta keep your eyes open to see what might be happening, because the hawks are around, whether they're going to build a nest, come back to this nest or wherever, but they're definitely still here.
They are. And keep up with the blog to find out where they are.
That's great. That's great news.
Up to date. I think at this time we're ready for some questions, Amy.
Great. I think that's a great idea, Jen. People have questions?
All right. Thanks so much, Amy and Jen. That was great. Really fascinating. So we have some great questions from people watching at home. I have a question from Leslie. So we talked about it a little bit about the expectation, of the hawks coming back to the same area. Is there any expectation that they'll be using the same nest again this year?
It's quite common for them to reuse the nest year after year if it worked out really well the year prior. And as long as it's in good condition, of course, they're going to add to it and make it stronger if they choose to come back to that one. But we're crossing our fingers, hoping they do come back to that nest.
People should start looking in about 3 weeks.
That's right.
Oh, nice. That's exciting.
Yeah.
Look forward to.
Yeah.
And Leslie also asks, do we have any idea where they might have gone when they left the nest and where they might be now?
Oh, they're still around. They're within 2-3 miles all the time here. And I saw them today, actually. And we hear them all the time, too. So you'll see them in Tregaron Conservancy. I see them quite often crossing the bridge, crossing Connecticut Avenue.
You see them soaring, too.
Above the Kennedy Warren. For some reason, they love to circle the Kennedy Warren. So they're still around.
Here.
They're definitely, look up, they're around.
Nice. So I had some great questions coming in, and not only just about the hawks, but about your work, Jen, as well. I had a question from James. What type of camera do you use to get these incredible shots?
I use a couple of different cameras. I shoot a Canon 5D SR, which is a full frame camera, and I use a lens, a 600 millimeter lens, so that I can get the details pretty close. So that's a full frame camera, but I also use the Canon Mark II, which is not a full frame, but for you techies out there, you know that it gets you a little bit closer, even though it's not full frame. So if a hawk is really far away, I know that that's the one that I should use to bring them close. But remember, the best camera you have is the camera you have on you.
Remember to take it with you, right?
Yes.
Isn't that the truth?
But if you don't have a camera, I suggest bringing binoculars so that you can see them close up as well.
So that kind of leads to the next question that we got from Natalie. She mentioned that she also went to the bridge and she met a National Geographic photographer.
Mm-hmm.
Did either of you connect with him? And is any of the conversations that you met with anyone or him featured in the book?
No, we didn't cross paths, unfortunately. But we did meet a lot of photographers on the bridge, a lot of folks with cameras for several months. But not National Geographic. I don't know. Amy?
Well, I think the most professional photographer aside from Jen that I met was the Swiss ambassador, Jacques Lepiteau. And
mm-hmm.
he's lived in Africa and all over, and he is a superb photographer.
Yes.
In fact, he earlier this, probably was in January, he captured a kind of bunting that is unique, not to this area, and it was hanging out near, on the canal, up the canal at one of the locks. And it was a gorgeous bird, and Jacques captured that. So he was very, very much involved in taking photos of the hawk family too.
You know,
I actually ran into him at Great Falls when that happened.
Yes, yes.
Everybody went to Great Falls to see the bunting. You know, in the DC, Virginia, Maryland area, we have so many birders, people who are interested, and there are many clubs, camera clubs, bird clubs, lots of birds enthusiasts. And the really cool thing, especially for me personally, is that when you are surrounded by so many people that are interested in wildlife and photography, it just makes you more of a naturalist and a better photographer. So, you know, I think we've all learned so much in the last year.
So to the next question with that, what surprised you the most while photographing the nest specifically?
Oh, there are so many things. I think it was the relationships, the nurturing that the parents did. Right. I was very touched by it. They, you know, really showed a lot of care and love to the chicks and really doted on them. And I was surprised to see that the mother would bring greens into the nest to, you know, make it nice and soft for them. And so I don't know, I just found that very, very sweet that they—
I totally agree. These were caring, protective parents. And there was one— we don't always have wonderful weather, wind, rain, ice, whatever. And there was one drenching rainstorm over when the kids were there, they were still in the nest. And you took one photo of the drenched mama hawk, you know, just covering and protecting the three chicks and getting soaked. But
yeah.
But they really nurtured in a caring way.
They did. You know, I remember after some of those rainstorms, and we have so many here in the spring, you know, as soon as we could, so many people would run out and make sure that everybody was still there.
Right.
They survived the night through the storm.
Right, right.
Oh, you know what? I want to follow up on that question you asked me. What surprised me? I would say just the number of people who cared and were so interested. And I would say that really surprised and touched my heart too, that they were so into seeing, you know, these hatchlings survive.
Right.
And
right. Right. The people, all different kinds of folks caring and really wanting to share this whole experience.
I like to say that nature is a panacea for what ails us.
Well, it certainly was for us with the hawk family in the spring.
Definitely. I think you did, just based on the names that you chose. We had a question about, you know, did you or how did you identify the sexes of the hawklings?
Mm. It's impossible to tell. I did research on that, and you really can't tell for the first 2 years what the gender is. I just guessed. So
she'll always be Dorothy no matter what.
I know. Of course, whenever we see one now, we're like, it's Dorothy. It has to be Dorothy. Because we want it to be. So no, we're unsure of the gender until they're approximately 2 years. And then the males tend to be a little bit more slender than the females. And that's really the only way that I've found that you can tell the difference.
Sure. And I know, you know, both of you are, you know, more hobbyists than, you know, obviously like in the field, but do you know anything, you know, about particular, like the hawk itself and like how many are in the area or anything about like the hawk living in the area? We had a question about how many estimate. I looked it up and I saw that there's approximately about 200 in like the Mid-Atlantic area, but I wasn't sure if you knew anything about it from your research.
There's probably more than 200. I can say that they are not on the endangered species list, I'm so glad to hear that. And as part of the Migratory Bird Treaty Act, they are protected. So you can't kill a hawk or any raptor for that matter. And all of that has helped with the numbers, because before that treaty, people were killing hawks and it significantly diminished the population. But right now they're strong. As long as we keep the woodlands and also to kind of heed about toxins, you know, taking care of the rodent population, there's other humane ways of doing that. And if the raptors do not ingest toxins, of course, then it's a better situation. And also for you tree trimmers out there, if you can hold off on the tree trimming till after mating season, they really appreciate that. So the hawk population is going strong right now. Great question.
That's great. That was all the questions we had from the audience. Is there anything that either of you wanted to add?
No, I think that spring is coming and it's going to be great to keep your eyes open now in March to see whether the hawks come back to the original nest or maybe mm-hmm. they'll be someplace nearby. And tell Jen's blog. Report what you see to Jen's blog. That would be great.
Absolutely. I get a lot of emails and about, you know, hawk sightings around town and so forth. And that's really exciting. I love to hear about people's interest in wildlife.
Okay. Oh, here we got some hot gossip just in. Ooh. At the risk of exposing the hawk's privacy. Let's see, we'll put it on the screen. I saw two red-shouldered hawks mating in front of the Swiss embassy last week. Perhaps more hawklets on the way. I'm a birder.
Whoa.
The Swiss embassy, our ambassador friend must be busy.
Thank you, Julia, for that tidbit. Hawklets are on the way.
They're not like other birds that fly in flocks and things like that. They're there for life. So Walt and Libby are it.
They are. So hopefully that was them. I would like to say that thank you for everybody for tuning in, for your interest in wildlife and in nature, and for supporting Owl Moon Raptor Center by purchasing this book. It's really helped them a lot. They save so many raptors, among other entities that come to their door as well. A lot of creatures that they help. So thank you to them as well for their many volunteers. And thanks to all of you for appreciating wildlife.
Right. Thank you.
Thank you so much to both of you.
Jen and Amy, let me add my thanks. That was a terrific talk and really took us back to a great time when our spirits needed lifting and the hawks did just that. I do hope that Walt and Libby will be back on that nest and we'll see you all soon on the bridge. We want to thank our audience for joining us. We hope you'll come back on March 23rd when Pulitzer Prize winning author Diane McWhorter will be in conversation with Diana Vega and they'll discuss from Birmingham to Black Lives Matter. Until then, thanks again and be well, everyone. Good night.
Good night.
Bye, everyone.
Bye-bye.